أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم We stated yesterday that the phenomenal change that the Blessed Prophet made If we explore the tenets of his message, the basics, the foundational principles, and how he brought about his phenomenal change, we will find that he did not preach to them fundamentally. What he did was he made them question themselves. He ignited them. He aroused them and initiated them upon a journey. We stated yesterday that he questioned everything. He left nothing as sacred. He questioned the status quo. He questioned the being of God. He questioned God himself. He actually stated, how can God be so insecure that he requires your offering? How can God ordain you to indecency? How can God ask you to sacrifice your sons? Because the Arabs had a custom that they had to sacrifice in order to procure the pleasure of God. Pretty much the same as me and you give sadaqah in order to get more blessing. I'm not saying don't give sadaqah, I'm talking about the thinking behind it at times. We are so very insecure at times, there's no difference between us and them. And hence, this topic of revival, renewal, looking at what the Prophet did is all the more relevant today. Because we find ourselves in a pagan-like existence in the name of God and name of Islam with a greater sophistication. But at the core, it's the same old thing that is going on. Yesterday, we called it the pharaonic Islam. The pharaonic tendencies in the name of God and in the name of Islam. Nothing has changed. So what did the Prophet do? He questioned everything. He knew for a fact that Islam can only be successful if it is properly digested by their minds and their hearts. It cannot be dictated upon them. They have to arrive at it. And the natural human condition is one of liberation, in which one retains the right of questioning. Questioning to the core. If my God is the right God, then he should not flee from me questioning him. The last one who should flee from questioning is God. In fact, God invites questioning in the Quran. He encourages, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Do they not think about the Quran? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَخْفَالُهَا Or are their hearts feathered and sealed with locks? So what the Prophet did was, he questioned. Look at the verses of the Quran. Verse after verse after verse. Do you really think that God commands you to sacrifice little children? Do you really think God commands you to do tawaf naked around the Kaaba? Do you really think God commands you to cheat people whilst transacting? Are any of these things worthy of being attributed to God? The reason why he was doing this was because, as Imam Sadiq says, people who come to Islam through people leave Islam through people. But when people think and they understand the righteousness of a faith, the mountains can shake in front of them and move from their places. But these people are so firmly pegged, they will not waver in their resolve. This is the difference. When something is digested at my level, the problem with me and you is we are born inside a religion, inside a culture. That religion has indoctrinated us, that culture has indoctrinated us. There are aspects of truth in there, but a lot of it is nothing to do with God. Let me just explain this as we go into it properly. You see, as souls, we are very naive. I often give this example. And I used to notice this. When people used to convert, or as they say, revert to Islam, you would find that beautiful glow on their faces when they would come to mosques. And you would rejoice in the purity, virginity of the faith on their faces. After 4 weeks, they become like me. The glow goes. There is no more light upon them. They become judgmental. Whereas the first time round when they came, the state of purity and sincerity was such that they were untouched. They were not judgmental. They were righteous people trying to find out the truth for what it was worth. What they did was they made a quantum leap. They interrogated, they critiqued through reason. They came to a new faith. When they came to a new faith, naively they accepted the whole of the faith, without understanding that there are truth aspects in that faith, but majority of it is my interpretation, my ritual and my ceremony that comprises this faith. It has got nothing whatsoever to do with Islam at all. And after being rational, they become irrational once again. All that godliness goes from them. This is the thing that's happening. We come to Islam because there's beauty in there, but majority of this Islam is nothing to do with the Prophet or to do with the Quran. This is something that I have made in the name of Islam, that has remained as a part of Islam. And hence, we give ourselves a chance to rationally approach Islam once again. Now, we stated this yesterday as we go into this talk and we advance it. An appeal of a religion has to be in its rationality, that this religion makes sense. Just as we say to the ISIS, does it make sense that only you should go into paradise and that you are ordained to kill the rest of the humanity if they are not like you? Does it really make sense? Ask yourself. Had it not been for your Islam skewing your mind, and had you been true to your humanity, would you ever have chosen this course? The answer would be no. Had they been born in isolation of a religion, they would have never been like this. They have moved away from rational principles. And you will always find this, that whenever we are asked, why do you do this? We have to bring about lengthy arguments. So I ask the Muslim community a question. You are advocating that a person who changes his religion has to be put to death. Does that make sense? Nobody can explain this to me. It's nothing to do with the prophetic Islam. If a prophet were to come today and were to tell you, my religion is this, that if you believe in me, you will be saved. If you stop believing in me, you'll be put to death. Would you follow such a prophet? You would say it's a nonsense prophet, wouldn't you? But in the name of Islam, when somebody becomes an apostate, we all unsheathe our swords and we feel we are duty bound to go and kill that person. And that person has only changed his religion in order to find Allah that he can't find in Islam. How strange is this? The Quran gives Jannah to the Jews and the Christians. Yes? Again and again he's giving paradise to all of them. Islam doesn't even give Jannah to Muslims themselves. How strange is this? The appeal of a religion has to be rational. It has to make sense in itself. Now I ask you, how many of us in this sense are Muslims? Muslim is one who surrendered to the truth. Yes? Wherever the truth comes from, the Muslim accepts. The truest Muslim is one who can stand and break the idol that has been erected in the name of Allah and in the name of Islam. The greatest Muslim is the one who can say that this cannot be the religion of God. How can God ordain such waste of time, such inhumane, atrocious actions? So we say to the ISIS, this cannot be Islam. Do you know what they will do? They will point at ayat within the Quran and they will say, this is what Islam is telling us. We will say, this is not possible. These ayat have to mean something else. There has to be a context to these verses. How can God say, without any context, prepare your strength and go and kill people and my enemies? There has to be some background to it. How can an ayat come in isolation? And that is why the Quran has got Sha'anun Nuzul, the reason for revelation, No verse can be understood at the exclusion of the revelation, at the exclusion of the reason of revelation. How can we understand Quran at all? Otherwise we will be going and killing and cutting people's heads off. There's a verse of the Quran that says, what can be the recompense of the enemies of God, save that they are killed, crucified or banished? Such a draconian verse. We ask ourselves, how is it possible that Allah would say something like this? And for the Muslim, a non-Muslim is the enemy of God. Whereas that's not the case in the Quran. When we look in the revelation, do you know what it says? It says that a group of Muslims had ambushed a caravan and cut those people up and burnt them. So in response, this verse came, that what can be the punishment of the enemy of God, save that they are cut or banished. That verse is not a standalone verse. It's a verse in a context of its own. There's a reason for it to be revealed. So when we say to ISIS, if you were to revert to your inner godly status, to your intuition, can you justify taking slaves in the name of God? Can you justify killing people in the name of God? The answer will be absolutely not. This is what the Prophet did to the pagans when he came to them. He said, you have justified so many things in the name of God, but ask yourselves, does it make sense even in the name of God? The answer was, they themselves resoundingly said, this does not make any sense. So now, the absolute norm that the Prophet taught was challenge. Challenge each and every single thing, because it is your life. There is no guarantee that the other person has got it right. Even if it be Plato or Aristotle, at the end of the day, it's a human mind. He could have got it wrong. Does it make sense to you? Can you do this? Imagine giving the stakeholding of life, lock, stock and barrel, to a human being. Of course, after that, they become so confident that they carve their own destiny within no time whatsoever. These people who worshipped idols insecurely were breaking the greatest idol of insecurity. The people confined to Arabia now are ruling the mighty waves and looking towards the heavens. And Allah says, you will not penetrate it, say without force. And if you can, then penetrate the heavens as well. They are all yours. Didn't he? Look at how he empowered them, encouraged them. But the absolute norm he made was, question it. Even if something comes in the name of God, in the name of the Prophet, in the name of Islam, question it. Now I'll tell you a little story before we move on to the next part of this talk. There was a representative of the Prophet. He went to a nearby village. He said to those people, dig a trench. I, as a representative of the Prophet, ask you to dig a trench. So they dug a trench. He said, fill it with firewood. They filled it with firewood. He said, set it alight. They did so. He said, now, as the emissary of the Prophet, I ask you to fall into the fire. Here the people are perplexed. Some are saying, but how can we follow a mere mortal, even in the name of the Prophet, to go and kill ourselves when Allah has said you cannot do it? Our intuition says we cannot waste a life. Another group said, whatever the case, he is the emissary of the Prophet. If he tells you to fall therein, you should go and fall into the fire. The people who did not believe that person prevailed, and they prevented all of them from burning themselves. Later on, when the news reached the Prophet said, by Allah, had anybody fallen into that pit of fire, Allah would have burnt him in the hereafter as well. How dare people follow the creatures against Allah Himself? When Allah is telling you, don't kill yourselves intuitively and through the Quran, why would you want to kill yourself even if a prophet says so? Imagine this level of liberty. I'm telling the Muslim community today, the Sunnis and the Shias of the Muslims, and I'm telling the Christians and the Jews, your ulama tell you things. They are not Jibreel, they are not the Prophet. The Prophet himself left it open for people to question him and interrogate him. Those Sahaba, before they became Sahaba, were critical of the Prophet. It was through this heavy critique that they became the best of people. A righteous religion has to be based on rational foundations, and that requires a lot of critique. Something does not make sense. So what if this man has turned into a Christian? Why should I go and kill him? It's sheer nonsense. It doesn't make sense. Why should I be doing all these rituals? They are nothing but a waste of time. Why do I need your permission to feed a hungry mouth? Does my God not feed the Pharaoh himself? Did God not feed the Pharaoh? The amount of riches he gave to the Pharaoh, has he given anybody in the Muslim Ummah? No. If my God fed the Pharaoh, do I need a permission of a mullah to feed a hungry mouth? Really, does this religion at all make sense to any of you? Critical foundations, rational foundations based on heavy critique. After this, the Prophet gave them the second component, and that was to introduce within themselves a notion of a purposeful existence, not a robotic, mechanistic existence, but a real existence in which they felt that they were living, that they were alive, they were leading a worthy life. If you were to ask me, in the last 30 years, it is the same whether this Arif has lived or died. In the last 30 years, this man has not progressed even in the slightest. How do you call that a substantive life? He gave them a substantive notion of life. When the people analyze the Prophet, and they say, what was the key success of his revolution? The answer is, it wasn't an economic revolution, nor an ideological one. All of these things are there. It was a social revolution, economical one, so on and so forth. But the real thing this man did was, he gave them a sense of purpose within themselves. And he ignited them into a real life. Today, if we look at our existence within Islam, truly what Allah says in the Quran is so true. By the way, before I go anywhere, everybody is going to Jannah, yes? That's a guarantee. Jannah is there, don't worry. The embarrassment is that when I find my Lord and I see Him, the regret that I will have, that, oh Lord, Jannah You are going to give me anyway because of Your kindness, not because of my worthiness, but I failed in loving You and recognizing You, for You are the goal of all goal, not this paradise. See, when Imam Abu Hanifa said to one of his disciples that only the most fortunate will go into paradise, the disciple of Imam Sadiq came to him and he said, Imam Abu Hanifa, I said this. Imam Sadiq said, I say this, that only the most wretched will go into hell. Otherwise, everybody is going into Jannah. Yes? Because the Quran says, La yaslaha illa al-ashqa. No one shall go to hell save the most wretched. What I'm saying though is, imagine when we can have Allah Himself. Why settle with His paradise? When Allah in the Quran also says that I have more to give, that will be the great regret. What happened was that He gave them a sense of purpose. He says, look, your lives are not to be wasted. Now I ask myself, as Muslims, what about that verse in the Quran that says, they are not alive, they walk, they talk, they eat, they drink, amwatun ghayru ahya. They are dead, they are not alive at all. Had they been alive, their hearts would tremble in the awe of Allah. Had they been alive, their hearts would melt in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had they been alive, they would not sleep at night at the pains of the rest of humanity. Had they been alive, how can they sleep when their neighbors are hungry? Had they been alive, would they not do something about social justice? They are dead people. Whether dead people exist as the community of Fir'aun or as the community of Shia or Sunni, they are all equally dead. Which one of them is alive? Look at how frightened they are, these people. Allah says to them, I am sustaining you, yet they steal and lie for the sake of sustenance. Allah says to them, if I wake you up in the morning, I will feed you. Yet they lose their sleep of night for their sustenance in the morning, which may never come. He might decide to take them away at night. Had they been alive, would they be hurting each other's hearts? Is it possible that somebody cries for my dead father, my martyred father, more than me, that I should not fall in love with him? People are crying for my Hussein and I'm cursing them? Is it possible? Amwatun gairu ahya. Or they are like the cattle, but worse still, they have no sense of existence, no sense of purpose. What about you inside yourself? Are you leading a worthy life? You feel bad at what he says and what she says. Have you even found God? Had you found God, would you be this petty in your existence? That he can smile at you and makes your day, and she can frown at you and breaks your heart? Really? Can Layla steal away your heart so easily, O man of God? Shouldn't your heart have a greater purpose? By Allah, had you been alive, you would be in a different world altogether. This is what Muhammad Rasulullah did. He gave them a sense of deep purpose. Do you know, all these addictions that we have, all these obsessions that we have, these are fundamentally yearnings for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are misplaced. If only we could find that out within ourselves. If only we could understand it. That our purpose is something else. Lead a purposeful life. Every breath should make a difference. When I breathe, this air comes inside me. I feel it. And I say, oh air, be benevolent to me. Oh Lord, I thank you for this breath. It's a purposeful life. But in the heat of the day, I find a shade. I say, oh Lord, inni lima ataytani faqir. Like Moses said, oh Lord, I'm a beggar, a pauper to you for whatever you give me. And that shade is the greatest blessing that you've given me. A purposeful life is one in which a person awakens, lives substantively. You have got so much knowledge, let's say. You've read so many books. You've got an institution. You have memorized so much. You give speeches. What about you in yourself? By acquiring books, you are still the same person. 20 years ago, you had no sense of existence within yourself. 20 years on, you have no sense of existence within yourself. 30 years ago, you used to crumble under challenges. 30 years on, you are still crumbling under challenges. Despite all of these things, what has happened to you? He gave them a sense of purpose. He said, lead a substantive life. Now, go into this reading and think about this properly. And if I'm getting a little bit excited, forgive me. Recite the salawat. Think about it. Why are we not satisfied? We are not satisfied in life, are we? If you people were satisfied in life, you would not be sitting here listening to me. You'd be on your musallas. You'd be with your families. You'd be having a nice feast. You'd be contented people. If I was satisfied in my life, I would still be here with you. Salawat. We are all searching for something, aren't we? Because we haven't found it. We're all searching. There is no satisfaction there. Nothing brings us surety. There is nothing that brings substantive existence to us. I'll give those verses of the Quran that you've heard from me before. When I was 16, the first time I came across the Quran, I read these verses and I said, really? Are they people like this? In that year, I read it again. And I said, yes, I have seen such people. In the same year, I read it the third time. And I said, by Allah, it is me. He's talking about me. He's not talking about anybody. It's me. Allah says in the Quran, two or three verses through which we can explain ourselves better. He says, have you seen those people who are moved away from God? They are overawed in whatever they have done and whatever they have gained and amassed. Little do they know, whatever they have done, whatever they have amassed, is like dust upon the surface of a rock. They turn to retrieve whatever they have. A gust of wind comes and blows it all away. In a frenzy, they're trying to grab whatever can come to them. I could not understand such verses. Then I said, I relate to this somebody. I have seen somebody like that. Then I said, it's talking about me, myself. It's actually me. This is me. Despite all my fasts, despite all my prayers, despite all my Quran, this is me. There is nothing in there. I am not leading a purposeful life. I am creating constant purposes for myself in order to delude myself that I'm leading a worthy life. But I don't find any of it worthy deep within me, because I haven't arrived at that pedestal where I can say to my Lord, O Allah, here I am. Take me. O Lord, I am happy with you. I am pleased with your decree, my God. I could not have done it any better. I have not arrived at that pedestal where I say to my Lord, O Lord, I thank you for the breath of air that I take. I thank you for the steps that I take. I thank you for this friend that you gave me. I thank you for this enemy that came to me. It wasn't an enemy. It was you who came to me as a test. It was you who came to me to awaken me to a greater pedestal of existence. I don't find myself at that level. Have I even led a life as a Muslim? So what if we have libraries upon libraries? If we memorize the Quran? If there is no purpose inside there, there is no purpose. Or the verse in which Allah says, "Aw kasayyibin minan sama," like a lightning from the sky. It frightens them to death. They plug their ears at the clap of roar of the thunder, the fear. But their state is such that only under the light of the lightning can they walk. فَلَمَّ أَظْلَمَ عَلَيْهِمْ قَامُوا. And when it becomes dark, they sit down. I was just thinking, what is this? And then, from Tehran to Mashhad, I understood what that verse meant. When their planes start jumping in the air, and the fear grips you, my God, you begin to understand this verse, that I am so frightened out of my wits that I say to Allah, oh Allah, I promise you I will do this, I promise you I won't do this, I promise you I'll be a righteous person. Do you know this? This is what I do. And I realize this is the verse of the Quran. And then when they are sitting happily, we bring stormy winds to them. And when their craft is shaken, they implore Allah and they seek Him and they beg Him. They lose all sense of protocol and they begin to cry out. They lose all sense of shame. Oh Lord, save me from this. And as soon as calm winds come, they go about their former ways. And I said to myself, Arif, isn't this you? This is you. You going to the Imam, you going to the Kaaba, you reading the Quran. None of them has been you really, is it? It's all been artificial. It's all been something outside you. None of this. The reason why? It's because I never awoke to the truth. If I were to only have taken that step of critiquing and finding God properly, then would I start living a purposeful existence and a purposeful life in which everything makes a difference. Do you know why the Prophet used to worship Allah the way in which he used to? Think about this carefully. Lady Aisha narrates that his feet would swell up. Yes? So she would go to the Prophet. She would say, "Oh, Messenger of God, has Allah not told you, 'Laqad ghafara Allah laka ma taqaddama min dhanbik wa ma ta'akhkhar'?" It's a verse of the Quran. Allah has forgiven you all your sins, those that have gone before and those that are to come after. He did not know how to explain to Aisha. So he just said one thing, "Awalam akun 'abdan shakura." Should I not be a grateful slave of Allah? Does it not befit me to thank Him therefore? But the truth was that the Prophet realized something that me and you have not realized. If we were to awaken, we will see that this life is a big debt of ours. It's a big debt upon us. God did not have to make this universe. He did not have to prepare all of this. But me and you, as the Quran says, and this is what makes rational sense, begged him and sought this opportunity of life. He went out for trillions of years, all of this happened. No matter what we do, we become more and more indebted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that through my actions I can never become worthy of paradise of God. It is only the favor of Allah that can get me into paradise. If we awaken and find God, then we begin to lead a purposeful existence in which day by day there is a different person emerging. There is something grand taking place inside them. The state is this, that Arif is changing the world, but he himself has not changed from within. Because of the statement I make, what do I say? I say, I want to feed the world. Why? Because I do not find hunger righteous. This is a statement of arrogance. Statement should be, because humanity does not befit a state of hunger. Yes? Not I. So this is what we're saying, that he gave them a purpose. He gave them such a noble purpose, that these people were able to forgive age-old rivalries. They were able to let go. When the Meccans came to Medina, the community of Medina made a pact of brotherhood with them. They gave away half of their property to their brothers of Makkah. So easily were able to let go. They said, if Allah, who has sustained us this much, is pleased with this, then that means more to us than 50% of our wealth. And if he has given this much to us, he can give us far more than this. They began to lead a life of purpose. Today, if we are finding that the world is in a state of turmoil, it is only because the world does not have a substantive purpose to live for. Their lives are the same from day to day. They don't have a noble end that they are yearning. And that noble end has to be within us. Now the Prophet said that he whose 2 days are the same is a person who has been cheated. Why? Because 24 hours of opportunity have elapsed and that person has not gained. It is like me and you saying this to a student sitting, preparing for his final exams. You've only got 7 days. Only got 7 days. This is the amount of reading you've got to do. You will not be able to finish all of this reading. Be selective. Read selective texts. Now in those 7 days, when that person has to read selected texts, if that student were to party all night long and to sleep all day long, what will we say? We will say, you are being cheated and you are cheating your own self. You are supposed to use this one day purposefully. Gain the knowledge that you're supposed to gain. You have given 24 hours. You only have 6 more days to go. You don't have time to waste. Lead a purposeful life. Now, the beauty about purposeful life is that in a purposeful life, we don't have to go and change the world. All we have to do is invite deep meaning in whatever little we are doing. It has to be full of meaning. Tell me, how much of the universe are me and you feeding? None of it. You heard the story of the great Sulaiman, in which he said, O Lord, allow me to feed the creatures of yours for a day. You know the story, yes? The fish came and opened its mouth. Sulaiman, complacent at his abilities, summoned his armies of man and jinn and beast, and he said, feed this creature of God. By nightfall, the fish was saying, Sulaiman, I'm still hungry. You have taken over this day's sustenance. Feed me. My Lord always fed me to the full. Today, feed me. Sulaiman fell with humility inside that prostration, he said, "Oh Lord, you are Razzaq, not me." What I'm saying here is, how much of this universe can me and you feed? How much of the creatures of this earth will we feed? God does not expect any of that. What he expects is, try your best, but if you're going to lead a life, it's your opportunity. You have to gain from it. There has to be purpose for you. You have to evolve through this life. It's like somebody, a student, who is giving to all his fellow students books and encouraging them to read, but fails to read himself. Our story is like that. That I myself am not reading. I'm encouraging the rest of the world to read. But what about me? I have to sit that exam as well. This is what we mean. A purposeful life is one in which when we go to sleep at night and we are in a state of reliance to Allah, we are confident of Allah. That, oh Lord, if you take me on this night, then I'm pleased with you. If you awaken me in the morning, I will thank you for another day's opportunity. Every day we are gaining. Whatever little we have, we make the most of that. So now, why do people suffer from anxiety, from fear? Why do people have phobias? I know these are psychological conditions, but majority of the psychological conditions in the modern world cannot be cured. People become depressed, they have Prozac, and it kills them even more. And when they remove them from Prozac, they commit suicide. Yes, people are moody, they are depressed. The poor humanity, it lacks that deep sense of existence. If a person is living a purposeful life, do you think that sort of a person is afraid of darkness or spiders? People are afraid of each other. I'm not joking, this is a very serious thing. This is because of this lack that we have deep inside ourselves. What the Prophet did was, after awakening these people, he gave them this beautiful sense of purpose. You have an opportunity. You are leading a life, and this life is something glorious. This is what the Quran does. At the second level, the Quran begins to challenge the minds. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ. Do they not contemplate? Look at the camel, how it's been created. At the heavens, how they've been elevated. At the earth, how it's been spread. What happens is that when people begin to think, they begin to realize that there is something grand going on. Have you ever thought of the camel? It has this long neck. It has heavy eyelids. It has humps. It has hooves. It's an animal that can survive in the desert climate. No other animal can survive. It can go for days without drinking water because the desert has oases far apart. It can see with its long neck above the sandstorms. It has heavy eyelids that protects its eyes from sand. Did the camel create the desert? Did the desert create the camel? Allah is inviting us to think. Think. There is something mighty going on here. There are signs in there for all of you. Awaken. Lead a proper life. Again he says, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And in another place, إِنَّ فِي اخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ. In the creation of the heavens and the earth, in the changing of the day and the night, in the flowing of the ship, there are great signs for people who think. When they begin to think, they awaken. When they awaken, they begin to lead a life that is a real life. Everything in this life is so meticulous, so purposeful. There is a purpose in this life. My purpose is that I should gain existence at every point, no matter how God keeps me. If He keeps me in health, there is a purpose I have to attain through it. And my purpose is to find God through this health. If He keeps me in sickness, there's a purpose I have to attain through it, to find my God through this sickness. If He keeps me in riches, in poverty, in humility, in dignity, in whatever way He keeps me, There is a purpose that I have to attain. Now today, if an offer comes to me, which is something unbefitting, then that's a challenge for me. A purposeful life is that I arrive at a pedestal beyond my lower self and say that if this is displeasing to my Lord, then I let it go gracefully and not cry about it. So this is what the Prophet of Islam did. He brought about a deep sense of purpose within the people. This is a story that we find in our Imams. The fifth Imam, in the heat of the day, was reclining upon his servants and he was transacting. So somebody passes by and he said, Yabna Rasulullah, are you transacting? He said, yes. He said, it's the heat of the day. Are you so greedy for the wealth of this earth? Shouldn't you let it go and rely on Allah? The Imam smiled. He said, by Allah, if he were to take me in this state, he would be pleased with me. He said, because within myself, I am doing this for the sake of Allah. And that comes and revises every single thing that we know. Now I want to finish with these words. Of what worth are those 100 rakats that we pray, yes, in Ramadan, in which Allah is not to be found? Isn't it better to sit with the family instead? With the children, spend some time with them? To see to the neighbors? Of what worth are these tarawis that the Prophet did not pray? Isn't it better to sit with your wives? To relax? Rather than praying a tarawih and 100 rakat namaz, after which we become foul-mouthed, after which our heads are spinning. A purposeful life does away with these things. The Prophet of Allah said, that small act done with the calmness of mind and regularly is far more pleasing to me than the other acts that are arduous and done only at some parts of the year or life. A purposeful life changes everything. Allah says, if you give me one sajda, I will give you paradise. They said to the Prophet, give us paradise, guarantee paradise. The Prophet said, guarantee me a proper 2 rakat namaz and I'll give you paradise. A purposeful prayer. That this is me with my beloved. No single worry in my head. No distractions. If I'm going to pray, I will pray it properly. If I'm going to speak, I'm going to speak properly. If I'm going to give charity, I will give it properly. If I'm going to forgive, I'm going to forgive properly. That is the sort of life the Prophet introduced to his Sahaba. And we can see this. You have heard this, and I want to finish on this note. That the same people who used to butcher each other and could not tolerate each other at the battle of Uhud, you hear this story. The water bearer goes to a fallen hero and he says, go ahead of me, there's another one in need of this water more than I. He runs ahead. He says, there's yet another one. He runs ahead. The third one sends him to the first. The first one has already died. He runs to the second. The second has died. He runs to the third. The third has died. From the people who are so steeped in arrogance and wastefulness to people who are leading such worthy lives in which their death becomes a glorious death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us our sins, accept our ibadat and our prayers. May Allah elevate the ranks of our marhumin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to do good to His creatures and leave this world a little bit better than what we find it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase His light in our hearts. May Allah hasten the reappearance of our beloved Imam and grant us the grand boon of Shahada in His divine presence. Rahmallah man qara al-Fatiha.